All right, so welcome everybody. So this is a joint meeting. So normally I just welcome to Mobile Portland, but welcome to Mobile Portland, the Content Strategy Meetup, and also the UX Portland UX Book Club, or UX Book Club Portland. I can't remember the exact order of which, but we'll get to that in a moment. This is our basic agenda. We've got a little housekeeping to do at the beginning, and then we'll get on to Karen's presentation pretty quickly. So briefly, how many of you, this is your first Mobile Portland meeting? Could you raise your hand? And you haven't even been to one, so you can count it or not count it, it's up to you. But in case you're interested, this is what Mobile Portland is. We are entirely focused on mobile. We meet the fourth Monday of every month. Today is the fourth Monday, you just don't realize that. Your calendars are all wrong. The reason we meet on the fourth Monday of every month is because there's an international organization called Mobile Mondays, and you can find a Mobile Monday in pretty much every city. So if you're interested in mobile technology, you can find those sorts of organizations. We have topics on mobile, and what we try to program our topics in three categories. One from order of either business and marketing, one that is social, sort of impact of mobile technology, whether that's like mobile and education, or we've had presenters in the past from Sustainable Harvest talk about how they're using mobile technology for coffee growers. And then we also have technical sessions. So we usually end up with a bit of diversity from month to month. There's a Google group if you're interested. If you want to just receive updates in terms of when the meetings are, you can go to mobileportland.com and subscribe to that list. Or if you subscribe to the Google list, you will get not only meeting announcements, but also job postings and questions. There's a Twitter account, and then there's an IRC channel, which, how many people are on it now, Matt?
It's officially dead at this point.
We have revived it in this meeting.
Not enough geeks in this group.
You could prove that wrong. So there is an IRC channel. You should go hang out there. You could instantly, like infinitely multiply the number of people in that channel. Jim is going to talk briefly about Portland Content Strategy Meetup. Where is Jim? There is Jim.
I'm Jim Wolfrey, one of the co-founders, co-organizers of Content Strategy PDX. You can find us, we're a meetup group, free to join, and we try to put on something once a month or so, sometimes have a little lull here and there. And we're focused on talking about content strategy, which is all about the identifying, creating, delivering and governing content. That's a good way to put it. We meet, we'll have a book club once in a while. We invite some people to come and have a discussion, and we talk about tools and methodologies and things like that. So if that's something of interest to you, find us on meetup.com and or at Twitter at cs_pdx. We'll look forward to meeting at the next meeting.
Awesome. And then we've got Francis to talk a bit about UX Book Club PDX.
Woo!
Hi, my name's Francis. I run UX Book Club PDX. Been running the last year or so. We meet every couple of months. If you haven't been before, it's usually UX books. If you didn't come last 2 weeks ago, we missed a great session. We had Jeff Goff on Skype talking about the new UX book. That was really useful. And previously, we've also had Mike Montero on Skype talking about his book that designs a job, which was an awesome session. We are going to meet you next in July. We are going to be Dan Sackers, New York, Fine Micro Interactive's book. We are on Twitter, on UX Book Club PDX. There is a Google group, but I can get around to it one at a time. But if you Google UX Book Club PDX, you will find it. And it's really low traffic. I just send out an email and say it in 5 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you, Francis. And thank you to both groups for helping organize this, helping get Karen here. It's been great. Okay, so we've got opportunity for job openings or announcements. So if people are looking to hire people, please raise your hand and I will wander around with a microphone. Looks like Scott, of course.
Thanks, Jason. My name is Scott, I'm with Tech Systems. We're the largest staffing agency in town, and we've currently got more jobs than we can fill. So if you know anyone who's looking for work, or you yourself are interested in hearing about opportunities, I'll be here afterwards. If enough people are interested, we can go grab some beers over at Bailey's and talk some more. So yeah, let me know.
Anyone else? I usually let Matt do this.
Thank you. I'm Anna Marie. I work for Viewpoint Construction Software. We're hiring for a new iOS mobile team. And then we've got other network administrators, systems developers, engineers, and architects.
Others? Hey, so my company, Cloud4, we're hiring. We're looking for a JavaScript developer, somebody who really wants to build like the next like mobile, like awesome forecast.io type thing. So if you're interested in that, or if you know anyone, please let them know. That would be really great. A couple of additional items just to get through briefly. Last month, or the last time we had a meeting, which was in March, there was an incident that happened, actually a couple of incidents, but I blogged about this on Mobile Portland. I don't want to go into tremendous detail about what happened, but there was basically some disrespect shown towards a woman who was here, and completely unacceptable. We are an open organization. We accept people regardless of race, orientation, gender, any of those sorts of things. So. You know, we've never had to have any sort of policy in the past, but I'm just going to let you know that if you're a jerk, we're going to kick you out. But otherwise, I think in 5 years of running this group, everybody's been nice except for this one guy, so I'm expecting that to be the case from now on. So some of it's really strange to have to talk about that. So let's go to better things. So there's some upcoming meetings. Microsoft is sponsoring this App Factor Hackathon on June 7th, and there's limited seats. You go to Microsoft's facility for a day, you learn about how to build stuff for Windows 8, and then you can participate for like 2 weeks, and you get access to their developers, and then there are like prizes you can win, and it's you know, obviously based after that reality TV show that I've never seen. But I'm assuming that, you know, the TV show probably sucks, but this sounds pretty cool, so if you want to check it out, that would be good. Open Source Bridge is happening in June, which is this awesome open source conference that's also open source itself. All volunteer run, so if you have not looked into it, you should. We have a meeting in the fourth Monday in June, and we have a line on what I think would be a really cool talk. I'm not sure if it's going to pan out, but crossing my fingers on that. Then we've got OSCON coming up in July. Then for those who are interested in mobile web, the Breaking Development Conference is a really awesome conference I've had the opportunity to go to. And it's actually in San Diego, which is a very short Alaska Airlines flight. So I wanted to highlight that. And then the next meeting after that would, in theory, be the 22nd of July. But I'm just gonna give all you all a heads up that it's not going to be on that date. Because if you notice, that date conflicts with the Breaking Development Conference, and we're sending everybody from Cloud4 there to that conference. And so the people who organize the meeting won't be here on that date, so we're going to pick a different date. Yes?
How do I find this page?
So we've got an event calendar on our site, mobileportland.com/events. And then if you just want to find this list, you can do /list, because I built it so that I could make screenshots real quickly for the meetings. I've never told that before publicly, so, but it's going out in the main way, so now it's going to be like our top page.
Okay, the next thing. So we organize, oh yes, Jim?
Yeah, I just want to announce also we have an event coming up on June 13th, the Content Strategy PDX group. We're doing a workshop called Write Tight,
June 13th,
Write Tighter, and it's at, you can go to meetup.com and find us there and sign up. And we announced it yesterday, we have room for 70 or 65 people, and it's almost full already. So,
So if you want to do it, you should like use the free open internet, which is posted over there, and register right this moment, and see how fast you can beat the other people in the room. Okay, device lab. So we organized a device lab. We incorporated Mobile Portland as a nonprofit so that when people are working on projects and they need to be able to test them on a variety of different devices, they can do so. We had intentions to create this as a physical location, but for the last few months we've been hosting it at our company, Cloud 4, and we do get a lot of traffic. Like, people have been in our office 2 or 3 days this week testing on devices, which is awesome. But 2 or 3 people per week does not justify getting a separate space. So we're going to stop working on that and instead just continue to host it. So if you're interested, there's I think like 50 devices or something that are there. You can go to the website, you can find out what the devices are. You can come test on the devices, like check out what you're working on. And then just fill out the form so that we can make sure that the devices are ready for you and that somebody's actually there to open the door so that we're not at lunch or drinking or something. Karen has an awesome, awesome book, and you get a discount code if you use UX Book Club PDX2 on the Book Apart site. I do not know how much of a discount you get, but the books aren't really that expensive anyways. It's a fantastic book, so if you haven't bought it yet, you should buy it. You could even like grab a napkin or something and have her sign that in advance, like if you show her the receipt, she'll let me do that. I didn't pre-approve this with her, so we'll see how it goes. But you should do that. And then I wanted to bring up Catherine Gray, who has helped organize this and brought Karen here. She helps with the Content Strategy Meetup to introduce Karen. Catherine.
Hi, I'm Catherine, and I'm
Karen's
co-founder and co-organizer along with Jim for our Meetup. If you haven't had the pleasure of hearing Karen speak before, I've had that pleasure several times, and one of the things that I love about Karen's talks is that there are always some kind of call to arms. I had the pleasure of seeing this talk right before the book came out at CONVAP, and one of the keynotes, and pretty much everybody was her speech for the rest of the conference and for months afterwards. And if you haven't read the book yet, after this lecture, you'll want to get it. Right now, Karen is the managing director, I don't know if that's my title, of Bond Art and Science. And before that, she started the UX consultancy at Razorfish. And we're also really lucky to have her here tonight. She has made the rounds of Portland at all the conferences that are in town, plus several private viewings of her work, and I imagine she's very tired, and so we're very lucky to have her here tonight. So let's bring up Karen.
The big reveal with my laptop here. Largest computer company.
behind only the 500-pound gorilla of the industry, IBM. And Deck made its success in the marketplace by their manufacturer of what they call mini computers. See, back in these days, if you wanted to buy a computer, you had to like clean out your basement and install this some giant thing and like hire this team of acolytes to run it for you. And so computing power was reserved for only the most high value business tasks. So, you know, if you wanted to add some numbers, basically you had to get in line behind payroll and calculating the insurance premiums and, you know, doing all the other things that the business needed to operate. So Deck was able to be successful with their one of what they call mini computers. They were able to sell something that was like maybe the size of a large refrigerator. And so back in the start of the 1960s with their PDP line. And with this, they were able to give computing power, market computing power, to a smaller end of the market. They were able to sell computers to an individual academic department or an individual engineering department. And so this allowed them to break into new markets. Their real success, their big breakthrough product came with this sexy badass right here, the PDP-8. So this, I have this fantastic photograph of, it's like this really grainy black and white photo, reproduced terribly, there's no way I'd ever show it, but what it shows is this photo of a farmer who has loaded one of these things onto the back of his tractor so that he can use it to do computerized potato picking, which is insane. But it also kind of suggests that, I think to me, it says that the PDP-8 here was the world's first mobile computer. So, this is Ken Olson. He's their CEO. Look how happy he looks. Doesn't he look happy? He's really happy. And, you know, why shouldn't he be happy? He is the CEO of the world's largest computer company. He has an unparalleled track record of, you know, understanding the needs of the marketplace, of putting out new computers that address what his customers are asking for. He has done his research. He knows in what direction his company should innovate, and he has the technological prowess to bring out new lines of computers, new equipment that meet the needs of this market. And he knows that there is no reason for any individual to have a computer in their home. I mean, why would you want that? That doesn't make any sense. That doesn't square with Ken Olson's understanding of how people use computers. That doesn't align with what he knows about the marketplace and what it is, what reasons people have for buying computers. Pretty sure there's somebody in your office right now that is telling you there's no reason anybody's gonna need to do that on mobile. I mean, that's not how people use computers. I have a model in my mind of what it is that somebody does with a computer, and it's certainly not that they would want to do it on this stupid little plastic device that they carry around in their pocket, right? So, imagine the scene. Late 1980s. Deck has moved on from their historically wildly successful line of PDP computers. They are now marketing the VAX line of computers. This is the VAX 11. It's the first 32-bit architecture mini computer. They sold 400,000 of these things. These things are wildly popular. They are marketing the VT125 integrated graphics terminal. This is the most popular graphics terminal on the market. It is selling like hotcakes, not just to their own customers, but to customers every other mainframe out there. This thing is a badass too. I mean, it's like you can do fonts, you can do all kinds of like graphics, charts and things, rainbows shoot out of these things. Look at this guy here. Look how happy he is. Doesn't he look happy? You can't really see how happy he is, can you, because of the giant mustache, but I want to assure you, he is thrilled with the VT125 integrated graphics terminal. So, you have to imagine, it's like, they are sitting on top of the world here. They're the world's second largest computer company. Their two main products that they are marketing right now are at the top of their marketplace. And they have no reason to believe that their entire industry is going to be destroyed because of these cheap pieces of crap. I mean, look at them. This is not the VAX 1132-bit architecture. This is a cassette tape. It stores its memory on a cassette tape. This is not the VT125 integrated graphics terminal. This is a black and white television set from Radio Shack. It's only got that one dumb little rainbow. Rainbows don't shoot out of these things. They're plastic. They're like a child's toy. This in no way can compete with any of the products that DEC merchandises in any respect on which their customers would define quality or functionality or the reasons for which they would purchase anything. There's just no comparison. 1988, DEC is the world's second largest computer manufacturer. They're the second largest employer in the state of Massachusetts, behind only the state government. In 1990, just 2 years later, they post their first quarterly loss and they start laying people off. Sales of their products are ravaged by those cheap pieces of plastic. Just 1 year later, 1991, they post their first full year loss. They would lose money in 5 out of the next 7 years. And in 1998, just a decade later, they're gone. They're out of business. The entire company is acquired by the manufacturer of one of those cheap pieces of crap. This has got to be unprecedented, right? I mean, this has got to be one of the most crazy flukes that you've ever seen in the history of business. I mean, there's just no way that Ken Olson could have ever anticipated something like this happening, right? This is actually one of the most well-documented phenomena in American business. In industry after industry, the new technologies that brought the big established companies to their knees, they were better, they were more advanced, they were actually worse. The new products were low-end, dumb, shoddy, and in almost every way inferior. Almost. Clayton Christensen had a theory, he called it disruptive innovation. What this theory says is that disruption happens from the low end. New products come on the marketplace, and even though they are not better in any respect on which you would compare them against their larger, more successful predecessors, they are, in a sense, more expensive. It costs you more to get something that would do the same thing. They are slower, they are cheaper, they just don't do as good of a job. If they do one thing, and they do that one thing better than anything else out there, they give access to a technology to a population of people who never had access to it before. They create a new market for that technology. And, bewilderingly, mysteriously, unexpectedly, but yet, time and time again, demand for that cheaper, low-end product that doesn't work as well winds up disrupting the market for the higher-end product. Imagine it's the 1940s. You have this beautiful piece of furniture, this gorgeous furniture radio. It's a fine piece of craftsmanship. It's like beautiful, hand-tooled wood, the sound is rich and resonant. This is something that you gather the family around to listen to the radio. You invest in keeping this machine up and running. You imagine that it's an heirloom that you're going to pass down to your children. Except your teenager buys one of these cheap pieces of plastic so she can take it to the beach. transistor radios were not better. The sound quality was terrible. It was cheap and tinny. You couldn't tune these things. I mean, isn't that why you have a radio? Isn't that the whole point of a radio is the sound? Is there really any other reason that you have a radio other than to be able to have good sound? No, apparently not. And apparently, the desire for a teenager to have access to his or her own radio, to be able to carry it around with her, to be able to have it, you know, be her own thing, disrupted the market for the better piece of equipment. Within a couple of decades, nobody needed to buy furniture radios anymore. No one needed to keep them updated, keep them maintained. Because people wanted to buy transistor radios, eventually the sound quality became good enough. The names of the craftsmen that made these giant pieces of equipment that would sit in your living room, they're kind of lost to the mists of time, right? Nobody knows who they are. The name of the company that made the first transistor radio? Sony. Maybe you have an offset printer, an offset printer in your office? Why not? They're better. I mean, they're more expensive to buy, to start, but once you've invested the higher upfront cost, they make better quality printouts at a lower per unit cost. Isn't that what you want out of a printer? I mean, isn't that your goal for having a printer, is you want to make good quality printouts and you want them to be cheap? No, not at all. Every single one of you is like, I got a cheap inkjet printer. It's crappy printouts. The ink is really expensive, but you know what? I hook it up to my own computer. It's mine, my printer, mine. You are willing to sacrifice quality and cost so that you don't have to share a printer with anybody else. You are willing to sacrifice the very thing that the printer should do, just make good quality printouts, because you want the power of being able to have something that's your own device. We've just seen this happen with photography. Now, when digital cameras started to become a reality, everybody knew that digital was going to disrupt film. Everybody could see coming from, you know, a long time ago that film was going to be an artifact of the past, and everyone was going to have digital prints. You know what nobody saw coming, or you know what they really didn't predict? That digital devices were going to disrupt the very market for cameras. No one buys a point-and-shoot camera anymore. You know why? Because you were willing to sacrifice to have the device that you always have in your pocket. So you've seen the market for, you know, mid-level cameras totally disrupted. Now all you see is either people lugging around, you know, giant cameras with huge lenses, or they have the camera that's always with them, the one that's in their pocket. Kodak, bankrupt. Instagram, worth $1 billion. That is disruptive innovation. So you kind of see where I'm going with this. We are right now witnessing the latest wave of disruption. Clayton Christensen, the guy who came up with this theory, his most embarrassing prediction was that the iPhone would fail. Steve Jobs showed it to him. And remember, Christensen's a low-end guy. Christensen believes that this disruption happens from the bottom. And so when Christensen looked at the iPhone, all he saw was a luxury device aimed at the top end of the market. He saw a really fancy cell phone. What he didn't see was a really cheap computer. What he didn't see was a really cheap internet device, really cheap internet access, that made the internet available to a population of people who never had access to the internet before. The digital divide in this country is real. It is easy, I think, for people like us to fall into the trap of assuming that everybody out there is just like us. I, for one, I have had an internet connection at home since like 1994. I have like probably four or five computers in my house right now, and that doesn't even include all the mobile devices that I have. But not everybody has that. 20% of Americans do not have internet access at all. That number is actually less interesting to me than this next number, which is that 35%, more than a third, don't have internet connectivity at home. Now, think about all the stuff that you do on your personal computer, in the privacy of your home, that you might not want the prying eyes of your boss or coworker or strangers watching you do. I don't know what you're thinking about, but I'm thinking like checking your bank statement, maybe looking up a personal medical condition, looking for a new job, heck, even shopping for Christmas presents. These are all things that we take for granted. We can do in private, anytime we want, on our own personal computer. More than a third of Americans do not have that luxury. If you give them the opportunity to do that, it's transformational. I mean, think about what a big deal it would be if you didn't have personal access to the internet right now, and then one day you got it. Think about how much that would change your life. So this is a third of all Americans, but the population of people who don't have access to the internet is actually much greater when you look at populations of people who are more traditionally disadvantaged. It's about a third of Black Americans who don't have internet access, and 51%, more than half, don't have internet access at home. Numbers are about the same for Hispanic Americans, 32%, 49%. Numbers are even higher for low-income Americans, so 38% of them don't have internet access, and almost 60% don't have a connection at home. You have to imagine that this is the case, right? If you're struggling to pay the rent, put gas in the car, put food on the table, the internet would seem like probably a luxury that you just can't afford. Problem is, the tools for escaping poverty are increasingly out of reach for people who do not have access to the internet. 80% of Fortune 500 companies only advertise their job listings online. Resources, coupons, services, available to people who are low income could save them $8,000 to $10,000 a year. Only available on the internet. If you only make $30,000 a year, being able to save $8,000 to $10,000 a year is life-changing. You don't get that if you don't have the internet. If you have disability, 46% of people have no internet access, and again, almost 60% no connectivity at home. Imagine how small your life would feel if you were disabled and you couldn't even go online. Now think about how much bigger your life would be, how much access to community and services and information and healthcare you could get if only you could go online. If you don't have a high school diploma, 57% of Americans with no high school education don't have access to the internet, and a whopping 88% don't have a connection at home. I mean, imagine it. You don't have an education, you don't have a diploma, so that means you don't have a job, so that means you don't have any money, so that means you have no internet. And that leaves crystal meth.
Yeah.
You laugh now. If I took your home internet connection away, you would be stockpiling cold medicine in 2 weeks. It would be an episode of Breaking Bad in here. So, not everybody has the internet. You know what everybody has? Everybody has a phone. Phone ownership, mobile phone ownership in this country is not a luxury. It is a basic staple of human life, okay? This number hasn't even gone up that much in the last couple of years. I bet within the next few years, as some of these laggards, as some of these laggards die off, you are gonna see this number hit 95%. And barring some major new technological revolution, that will never change in our lifetime. Owning a mobile phone will be essentially the same as having a television set or having a landline was back in the heyday of the landline. Okay? Everyone will have a phone. Here's what has changed. Here's what's interesting. Population of people who say they have ever accessed the internet from their phone has skyrocketed in just the last few years. It doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure out why this number has gotten so much bigger, right? It's smartphones. You know, up until a few years ago, no one accessed the internet on their phone because their phone didn't access the internet because they had no big enough phone that did that. Today, think about smartphone adoption. Think about if it was time for you to go buy a new cell phone and you didn't have a phone, you had to buy a new phone, everybody's going to get a smartphone. Cheap Android devices are given away for free or at very low cost with your plan. And, you know, it's like what we're seeing here is that soon smartphone penetration is going to be essentially equivalent to mobile phone penetration.
and a whole population of people who has never had access to the internet is now going to have it in the palm of their hand. And that is, lots and lots of other industries have shown us, that is going to disrupt the marketplace. So this, what this means is that there's a rise of what I like to call the mobile-only user. So these are people who say that they only or mostly access the internet from their mobile device. And I emphasize, I've had people come up to me afterwards after I give this talk, and they're kind of like, well, Karen, they say that they mostly access the internet from their mobile device, but they still can access their desktop. And I'm like, whoa, whoa, whoa. That's why I emphasize so much about not being able to get connectivity at home. Yeah, maybe they have access someplace else, but their mobile phone is their device. It is their access. And that, for them, that is the internet. So, of that 55% of Americans who I told you have ever used their mobile phone to go online, 31% of those people say that they only or mostly access the internet from their mobile device. I talked to a friend of mine about this week, and he was like, Karen, I think this number, just based on the math, he's like, I think this has got to be bigger than the number of people who are on IE9. How many conversations have you had about how to provide a good experience for people who are on IE? How many conversations have you had about how to provide a good experience for the 2% of users who have JavaScript turned off? How many conversations have you had about how to provide a good experience for this 31% of people who will never see your desktop website? The numbers, predictably, are even higher for the groups of people who don't have access to the internet at home. It's 39% of people who have high school education, 43% of low-income Americans, 42% of Hispanic Americans, and a whopping 51% of Black Americans, more than half. And now, my point here is to talk about access to the internet to people who haven't had it before, but if you're interested in, reaching the youth of today, for people who are 18 to 24, this number is 45%, and for people who are 12 to 17 who own smartphones, it is 50%. Mobile is the final frontier in the access revolution. It has what has erased the digital divide. A mobile device is the internet for many people. So it's great that we're doing such a good job on mobile, right, everybody? 21% of large advertisers do not have a mobile website. One of my favorite things to do if I'm ever stuck someplace where I look at TV commercials is to note how many large advertisers put a URL in their TV spot. TV spots are expensive. You're paying a lot of money to put your URL in that TV spot. Why? You don't have a mobile website? 86% of people say that they watch TV with their phone in their hand. The other 14% of people are lying. 16% of consumer brands have a mobile strategy. 84%, or another way to put it is, 84% of consumer brands do not have a mobile strategy in place. Which stands to reason then, that only 14% of consumer brands say that they are happy with the results that they're getting on mobile. Numbers are about the same for B2B brands. Only 20% have a mobile strategy in place. The other 80% say they're just throwing stuff up against the wall to see what sticks. So what does this mean? Think about the experience of the internet. Try to put yourself in the mindset of somebody who doesn't have a home internet connection, who doesn't spend a lot of time on the web, and they're only accessing the web through their mobile device. And we say, oh yeah, here, oh look, nice big tappable buttons. Oh, this is really easy to use, isn't it? Oh wait. You can only do three things here. You want to do these three things? If you're already a customer, go right ahead. But if you want to do anything else, you've got to tap on this little link here for the full site, and then you got to go pinch and zoom your way around the screen designed for a monitor that's like 5 times the size. Just because we've gotten used to this, just because we can get away with this, doesn't mean this is an acceptable vision for the mobile future. I know how to navigate a website by pinching and zooming my way around. You know why? Because I make websites for a living. Because it's all I've done for the last 15 years is make websites. I have a really solid mental model of how a desktop website works. What if you don't have that? What if this is all you know? It's terrible. I mean, we can do better than this. Maybe you want to buy some cigarettes. Cigarettes are delicious. Marlboro wants to make it super easy for you to buy some cigarettes from them. You can log in to their mobile website. There's nice big tappable buttons here. You're an adult smoker. They want to market to you. Except there's that minor little detail where cigarettes will kill you. So, you know, they are legally mandated that they have to remind you that you might die. But that doesn't really have to be quite so easy to use on mobile. And then if you actually tap into one of these pages to find out about smoking cessation. All right, the desktop website. I mean, what does this tell you? I mean, what, I mean, it's like, could you see a better indication of an organization's values, what they care about, than to say, hey, we're gonna optimize our cigarette marketing and we're not gonna optimize the things that tell you that they're gonna kill you? Or maybe you wanna search for something. You type something into Google and then you find things in the search results. It's like the magic of the internet. Oh yeah, here, this is the thing I want. I'm gonna tap on this link and wait, what? How did I want, but that wasn't what I tapped on. How did I wind up here on a homepage of the mobile website? See, if a website has content that exists on the desktop, Google can see it, but they don't make it available on mobile, and they don't code things correctly so that they show you how to redirect, the server gets confused, and you wind up dumped unceremoniously on the homepage of the mobile website. And then you gotta go tapping your way around the mobile site where you're like, but that page that I wanted, it's there, I think. Where do I find it? Can I find it here? Oh no, maybe I'm gonna have to go over to the desktop website. Something that should literally be one tap. The page exists. You can see it. You can see it in Google. You just want that one page. It becomes this frustrating hunt and peck through two separate versions of a website trying to find the content that you know is there. For this segment of the population, for the mobile-only user, Google is broken. How can we as an industry stand here and suggest that this is acceptable? We are treating these people essentially like they are second-class citizens. We're telling them, the internet that you get isn't as good. The internet that you get is broken. The internet that you get requires a frustrating hunt and peck through screens that weren't designed. You get 8-point type. You get stuff that you can't find. You figure it out. These are the very people for whom this may be their first experience of the internet. We can do a better job than this. So what do we do? So my vision, my goal here, is not to ever stand up and you know, berate anybody into rushing out and throwing something up on the mobile web right away. Okay? In fact, I want you to do the exact opposite. If you are one of the 80% of companies that doesn't have a mobile website right now, I don't want you running off and just being like, oh, we have to put something up tomorrow. That's the exact opposite of what I want you to do. Instead, I want you to plan. I want you to focus. You need a content strategy for mobile. And totally coincidentally, it's really random how these things happen. I just happen to have a book of the same title, which came out from a book of art this year, and you can buy it. So what I want is for organizations, rather than freaking out and deciding that it's time to throw something up on mobile, I want them to say, hey, let's put a plan in place. Let's have a vision of what our desired end state is, and let's start taking some steps now to figure out what we're gonna do so that we can make, you know, even if it's baby steps, at least we're making baby steps in the right direction. So I wanna give you three things that you can start doing right now. Go back to your office and start thinking about these things. They're not throwing up a mobile website right now, but they are. Here's how you can start thinking about your content and planning for the future. So number one, you have to know the workflow through which people are creating content today. Too often, I will go into organizations and I will see that the right hand doesn't know what the left hand is doing as far as content creation is concerned. They, you know, I will sometimes go in and I will say, hey, can you introduce me to all of the people who can create content in the organization, or even, you know, a key subset of the groups that are allowed to create content? And they laugh, and they laugh, and they're like, we don't know. See, you know, we found that we had a big silo in IT, so we put in a content management system, and we gave keys to everybody, so now everybody can update their own content. And then with social channels, now all these other groups have started hiring people to publish social content, and we don't know where all the content comes from. We don't know who creates it, we don't know how it gets made, we don't know what the policies are around it. We couldn't even begin to tell you what that workflow is. Well, maybe now is the time to go in and start diagnosing what that is. Maybe now is the time to say, okay, let's try to figure this out. Let's try to map out who has this responsibility, how do they make choices about what gets published, how do we know if it's working, and how do we know what, you know, what are their pain points, what are the points of failure? You can map out this process or try to start diagnosing who's doing what and what the pain points are right now. You don't need to wait for a mobile strategy to make that happen. You can go in and say, okay, let's try to solve for some of our editorial problems. I had a former client contact me recently, and she said, Karen, are you just doing like mobile content stuff? Because I need your help, but I really need your help about just kind of overall content strategy. And I was like, all I ever do is overall content strategy. It's just that mobile is my Trojan horse that gets me into some of these organizations. If I go on and talk to the CEO about their editorial process, they show me the door right away. If I go in and talk to them about their mobile website, they're like, oh God, yes, we need a mobile website. And then I use that as my leverage to solve for this bigger problem. And trust me, mobile is the bigger problem here as far as some of this process stuff is. See, when I go into companies these days, I see that we have allowed mobile to make yet another silo in our organization. We have allowed mobile to become yet another team that is not incented to work with the larger desktop team. In fact, we have given that team incentives to go off and do their own thing. We have told them, basically, don't worry about the desktop, don't worry about the content management system, don't worry about the underlying base of content, don't worry about the content management system or the editorial process that it takes to maintain it. Just throw up a mobile website right now. That's not sustainable. That is not a long-term strategy. And we have baked that into our org chart. You don't have mobile customers and desktop customers, okay? You just have customers. And all of those customers, regardless, whatever screen size, platform, or device type they're using to access the internet, they deserve access to the same content. And so if you're baking into your org chart the idea that mobile can be something different, you are baking into your org chart that your mobile users are second-class citizens. That they're not, you know, I guarantee when the mobile website goes up, it does not have the same experience as the desktop website. You're telling all those mobile-only users, you get less stuff. You get not as good stuff. Comcast realized that they had a lot of users coming in from mobile devices. Surprise! So what they do, they made a mobile website. They went in, and they rewrote their content. They changed their content. This page here on understanding your bill, they updated it for mobile. It is the exact same information. It is the exact same ideas. It's just that on the mobile website, they edited it. Presumably, they were like, oh, well, the mobile-only, you know, mobile user doesn't have this page, so we should like clean up this text. What they did is they took long, jargony, wasteful paragraphs, and they tightened them up. This whole two-paragraph monstrosity, they say exactly the same thing in one sentence. The mobile website is better. But if the mobile website's better, why isn't it just the website? Most telling thing you can see here. Desktop website was last updated in March of 2012. Mobile website was last updated in July of 2011. They forked their content. They forked it into two separate versions. And now every time they want to make a change to that content, every time they've got an update, every time they want to make a fix, every time they want to change a typo, they got to do it in two separate places. This is not sustainable. There's no way that they can maintain this over time. Now, in contest to defense, I will say, when I talked to them, they were like, we knew exactly what we were doing now. We needed to get a mobile website up quickly, because we had you know, the traffic that was coming in from mobile devices was so high that we had to do something right away. We did this to buy ourselves some time so that we could make changes to our content management system to have something that was actually maintainable. And I'm like, okay, that's totally cool. I got no problem with that. But it's not a strategy if you can't maintain it in the long run. It's not a strategy if you don't have a plan in place for how that website is going to be managed and updated and maintained. And if your strategy is that you have a separate mobile website that's not hooked up to your CMS and you don't have a publishing process for how it's going to stay up to date, that's not a strategy. That's just throwing stuff up against the wall. So the second thing that you could do right now to make, get yourselves ready for mobile, you could do what you should have been doing all along and you could write better. One of my biggest pet peeves when I look at the mobile space is you see articles like this. Here's four tips for how to write for mobile. Here's how to write for mobile websites, top 10 tips. Here's how to write content for mobile sites, illustrated with a picture of a man using his laptop outside. I think this last one really sums up my point of view on the whole how to write for a mobile audience theme. See, there's no such thing as how to write for mobile. There's just good writing. All of the tips, all those top 10 tips that you see in those how to write for mobile articles are the exact same top 10 tips that we put in the how to write for the web articles, and they're the exact same top 10 tips that we put in the how to write good technical documentation manuals 25 years ago. It's all the same stuff. Write clearer sentences, write shorter sentences, don't use jargon, put the most important ideas up front. Use heading and bullet points to break up the text. These are all just principles of good writing, and you can use them right now. The American Cancer Society, when they were looking at what their mobile strategy should be, they tried to decide, you know, how should we approach this problem? Should we summarize our long and dense articles for a mobile audience? Should we, you know, make the mobile website the fun-sized candy bar version of our website? Should we focus on the needs of the on-the-go cancer patient? American Cancer Society, when they looked at their data, they realized something very important. The population of people who were most likely to be accessing their website from a mobile device was the exact same population of people who were less likely to get the kind of preventive healthcare screenings that they needed to catch cancer early. They were the people that I talked about before who didn't have access to a desktop computer. And so the American Cancer Society realized that they had a life-saving imperative to get all of their content on mobile. Not a subset, not an edited version. They needed their mobile website to be identical in experience to the desktop. And you know what? They did it. You go to their website, and it's actually a beautiful example of how they were able to take all of the information, and, you know, let's be clear, this is not trivial information. This is complex and serious and weighty material. And they were able to take it, and it's like, I'm fascinated by this, because I can go into these pages and I can dissect where every single bit of content was on the page, and they found a place for it. It's navigable. It's readable, it's browsable, and you know, I'll even go on record and say, I think the mobile website might even be better. It's easy to read, and most important, it is respectful of the people who maybe are newly diagnosed or have a family member that they're caring for. These people don't deserve less content just because they have a smaller screen. And the American Cancer Society was able to do this. They said, you know, we were able to make this happen relatively quickly, and you know why? Because they had great content. Their content was well written, and it was well structured to begin with. And it's not that they had to design and write that content for mobile. It was just good content. Good content transcends platform. If your content is well written and well structured today, you will make the leap to mobile. You can do that more easily. And that's something that you could do right now. You don't have to wait for your mobile website to make that happen. You can just go off and edit your content to make it better for everybody. And finally, it's time to start planning to put more structure into your content. Right now, we have too much content on the web where we are with the pages that we're publishing. We mix up all the content and the formatting information in a giant blob. where content editors or content creators have control over layout and styling decisions that unfortunately limit us when we want to take that content to another platform. What we need is clean, presentation-independent chunks of content that will give us more flexibility when we want to adapt that content for a different screen size. So you look at a typical desktop page, this one's here from PayPal, you see, okay, like, look at the layout here, you've got headlines, and body text, you've got images, product images, some of these images are valuable, they're actually pictures of a product, some of them are just decorative and they don't really have any meaning. You've got a demo video, the demo video is in Flash, you've got a call to action for each product. This is a fairly complex page. It's got a reasonably complex layout in which the hierarchy of products is, you know, there's some products that are featured and there's some products that are less important. And when you look at a page like this and you start trying to dissect what you're going to do with it on mobile, you have to kind of ask some questions about, okay, what it really gets down to is, what level of granularity do I have at which I can target each one of these different content elements? You look at a desktop page like this and you're like, oh, if this is all one blob of content, then it's really hard for me to be able to get in there and target which pieces I want when I need to get it on a mobile screen. And so you have to start asking yourself questions like, what's the ideal experience for that content? Meaning, what do I keep, what do I get rid of? Do I keep all of the content from the desktop? If not, you know, there's always this sort of like reflexive sense of, like, well, I don't really need all of the content from the desktop. Right, some of it probably isn't providing value. So how do you decide what to keep? How do you decide what to get rid of? If you decide you want to get rid of something, do you get rid of it for one device? Do you get rid of it everywhere? Do you break long pages into shorter pages? So if you are using responsive design, then there needs to be a one-to-one correspondence between what a page is on the desktop and what a page is on other platforms. The page is a container, and that container is sort of inviolable. That, and believe me, I'm a huge fan of responsive design, I'm in no way criticizing that as an approach, but you do start to go, wait a minute, there may be some scenarios in which a page, a long scrolling page on the desktop, keeping that keeping the boundary of the page around that content becomes limiting. You might want to break it into shorter pages. So how do you do that? Do you have the ability to target that content? Or, you know, how are you going to make those choices? And if you do make those choices, then you start to realize, oh, some of my desktop content is now going to start being used in new ways. So in this example here, things that were used as headings on my desktop page are now used as navigation links on mobile. So something that used to be on a long scrolling page where I could read and kind of look at the heading as sort of a break or a signpost to tell me what was coming next. Now, that language is something that I have to tap on. I have to be able to read that heading and decide, oh, is that going to answer my question? If I tap on that link, is the page that I'm going to get behind it going to have the information that I want? Most of those headings weren't written with that in mind. They were written to be read in the context of a longer page. When they start standing in to do navigation duty, you realize, oh, I would have written this differently. So now what do you do? Do you go back and rewrite the desktop content? Do you go back and tell the marketing team, hey, your marketing headline that you have there that has all those fancy words in it, we're gonna get rid of them and replace them with like more keyword-friendly navigation links. Is that gonna, how's that conversation gonna go? Same thing with body copy. So, blocks of body text here on the desktop site, like maybe I don't have room for them on mobile, or maybe if I'm breaking that page up, that content from the desktop winds up being a summary, a navigation summary on mobile. Is that gonna work? You know, here, I said, well, these blocks of body copy, they're too long, I'm just gonna truncate them after 100 characters. That'll be okay, right? Sure, you know, in an ideal world where everybody wrote really clearly and put really important keyword-friendly things in the very first sentence of their text, it might be okay. But again, this text was written to be read in the context of this page. Now that it's standing in as a navigation summary, it's doing a different job. It's providing a teaser for me to help me say, oh, will I answer the question that I want when I tap on that? Think about the person for whom their mobile device is their only access to the internet. They are paying for connectivity by the megabyte. You know, data might be, you know, their data plan might be an incredibly expensive part of their day. Do you want to be the person who says, oh, I'm going to make you reload all these like heavy pages, tapping around in my mobile website, trying to figure out if the content that you want, you know, lives behind door number two? And finally, what are we going to do if there's content, valuable content, that we've created for the desktop that simply won't work on mobile? Flash videos, giant tables, giant infographics, content that lives in hover states. All these things where it's like, right, we made good decisions about how the content should work because we were imagining it living in one and only one context, which was the desktop. And now, as we're trying to make this leap to mobile, we realize we have to go back in and restructure our content. I gave this talk recently and I outlined these issues and a woman raised her hand and she said, well, we're going to use responsive design. And I'm like, responsive design's not going to fix your content problem. Responsive design is not going to structure your content for you. Or maybe another way to say that is, these decisions that you need to make about how your content will be structured, you have to make whether you are using responsive design, whether you are publishing things out of your CMS, whether you're using separate mobile templates, like whatever your solution is for mobile, structured content is at the base of it. And you are never going to get away with not having to make some of these decisions. So when I talk about what the solution is, I want to be really careful that I'm like, hey, your solution is not going to be you deciding, oh, I'm going to write separate content for my mobile website, or I'm going to imagine how, you know, now I'm going to write this one special summary that's going to appear here in my iOS app. You know, you don't have time for that. So the solution is to imagine, is kind of like take a step back from all of the potential contexts in which your content might appear, and to come up with a flexible system that can be reused. The example I like to use is one of image crops. So I do a lot of work with the publishing industry. I did the redesign of the New York Times a few years back. And when you work with publishers, one of the things you realize is you don't get to crop a whole bunch of different image sizes based on wherever you want to put them in the design, okay? You don't get to go to a publisher and be like, well, on this page, I think a 400 by 300 image would fit perfectly. They're like, you get a 400 by 250 image, that is the size we cut, you will use that. Is it perfect? Is it a perfect fit everywhere it'll go? No, absolutely not. The sizes that, you know, that we decided on in 2005 for the desktop website probably aren't a perfect fit in every context that they might appear on mobile. So what? It's a system that works basically well enough. And you can imagine, oh, okay, it's like, right, we came up with some sizes, they work basically well enough, they have sort of made the leap to mobile, and you just go with it. So it's like, if you can wrap your head around the idea that somebody could create, in the abstract, a flexible set of image sizes that were not created for a particular context, they were not created to fit in a particular spot, but they work basically okay for whatever platform you need to get them on. If you can imagine that, then you can sort of wrap your head around saying, oh, we need to do that for other text objects too. One of the things that I find both hilarious and somewhat vexing on mobile is the number of websites that truncate their headlines. You know, the Daily Beast here was like, yeah, well, there's no possible way we've got enough room for this headline here because, you know, we need to have this giant summary and we want to repeat the name of the author, we want to repeat the author byline two times. Here, we just decided we wanted a bunch of white space. And I look at things like this and I'm like, You guys know that the whole point of your entire website is for people to read those headlines and then tap on those stories and read them, right? I mean, it just that is the whole essence of having a headline is that someone will read the entire thing. And, you know, it's like I make fun of the Daily Beast and then I turn around and it's like NPR is truncating their headlines in their mobile app. NPR, you're my go-to example for how to do things right and you're truncating your headlines? The Guardian has an entire Tumblr devoted to celebrating the work of the tireless men and women who shorten headlines so they'll fit on their phone. Who better than this? I mean, you know, this is, I look at this and I'm like, whoa, wow, this is the state of mobile content in 2013 as we are truncating headlines. I just have to believe that there are other solutions to this problem. So, but you know, it's like, and the thing is that solutions to this problem are not that hard. Come up with a couple of different alternate versions of headlines. Like, cut a short form. Cut a 60 or 70 character version. Gawker Media just recently mandated to all of their journalists that their headlines can be no longer than 70 characters. Why? Because they kept running into this problem. So I'm like, okay, cut a 60 character version. Send that short form to mobile, send it to Twitter, send it to SEO. But maybe cut a long form too. I talked with a client recently where they had a, you know, they had like a product name, product title at the top of their pages, and that product title was what got sent out as the email newsletter subject line. And they were like, oh God, marketing. Marketing, you know, marketing's like, we have to have a sexier email subject line. We have to go in and rewrite these things. So they're like, now marketing's going in and they're changing this product description field, and that means that that's then what shows up at the top of the page, and it's not right. And I'm like, so give marketing another field. Give marketing their own special field where they can put whatever they want, and if there's something in that field, then tell the robots that if this field exists, send that field to the email subject line. I'm like, this is like database 101, guys. I mean, this can be done. Same deal with the, you know, it's like, so the style, it's like, think about the combinations of packages that you could create where you've got a short form and a long form, or maybe one is chock full of keywords for the SEO robots to chew on, another form is written more colloquially, and you know, it's designed for to have puns in it or to make the marketing team happy. There's just all kinds of things that you can do to imagine how you would create a flexible system of content sizes. Same thing with summaries from Blockbuster. Again, here's an example of a page where the entire purpose of this page is so that you will read the description of the movie, presumably decide that you want to rent it and get it from Blockbuster. So Blockbuster, despite having quite enormous expanse of real estate here that's taken up with a bunch of garbage, decided that they just couldn't possibly know how much space to allocate for these summaries. And so here on the desktop, they give you 3 lines. Here on mobile, they give you 2. If you want to read the full description, you've got to tap or click to see more. Except sometimes you click and you get like 4 more words. It's like they kind of threw up their hands and said, well, there's no way we could possibly know how long this text would be. Blockbuster is bankrupt. You know why? Because of Netflix, digital native business. Digital native business kind of looked at this problem from a different angle and said, we're going to write a short form of our summary, we're going to write a long form. We're to use one or the other version every single place a summary needs to appear. Netflix is on something like 400 unique SKUs. It's on like 400 different device types. But they have the ability to go to their designers and say, here are the 2 sizes of summaries that you have available. Design around them. Make sure you have enough real estate for them and you don't have to truncate. So those summaries, they don't write themselves. You can't rely on magically the content that you created for one context to work someplace else. Verizon. I'm pretty sure there's probably somebody at Verizon who knows the difference between backup assistant plus, backup assistant SM. I do not. So if my task here is that I want to back up my phone, I have to tap into each one of these things, read the page, figure out if it's what I'm looking for. If it's not, I gotta tap back out, go to the next one. Jared Spool calls that pogo sticking. If you see somebody pogo sticking back and forth on a website, it means the website's not very well designed because you haven't given the user the appropriate context to know what he or she's gonna get when they click. Imagine you're paying by the megabyte to be able to navigate through a badly designed website. Now, Comcast, faced with a similar problem, wrote these short summaries, okay? So they have a short description that appears under each of these options that tells you what you're gonna get when you click. If my task today is that I wanna change my PIN, could I figure out that that's under accounts and identification? Yeah, sure, maybe. But by writing one short sentence that has the magic keyword PIN in it, I feel 100% confident that I know what's gonna happen when I tap. This is a technique called progressive disclosure, and what it means, essentially, progressive disclosure means give people a good teaser. Give people enough context so that they know what they're gonna get when they tap. So when I point out all of these examples of places where it's like, right, on mobile, you might need extra little bits of content that you don't have from the desktop, I'm not saying go in and write these things special for mobile. I'm not saying that you should create content for a specific context. What I'm saying is, if you were to think about for Verizon, for their backend assistant product, if they thought, oh right, what if we wrote a one sentence description of that product and we maintained it all in one place? Then we would have the flexibility to use that wherever we might need to. And writing those extra little bits of content actually really pays off. You will realize, oh, once you have things like an alternate form of a headline or an alternate summary version, you're not creating it with one particular platform in mind, but it gives you a lot more flexibility when you need to get your content onto, you know, the platform of tomorrow or something you haven't even thought of yet. And we're going to have to do that. Like that is the future that we have all signed ourselves up for. Because none of us here ever, you know, we don't get to decide what device somebody uses to access our content, to access our website. They get to decide that. They get to choose what they want to use. We don't get to get away with being like, nobody's going to want to do that on mobile. They can just use their desktop website for that. Like, it's our mission, it is our responsibility to provide a good experience to users on whatever device or platform or screen size or resolution they're coming in to access our content. That's our job right now. And you know, frankly, for all of the people out there who don't have any other way to access the internet, this is even more important. And the thing is, like, those are the people who are gonna disrupt the market for everything else. Those disruptive technologies, this, you know, mobile as a disruptor, mobile's eventually gonna get good. The argument that nobody's ever gonna wanna do that on mobile is eventually not going to be an argument that people make anymore. And it's because when you see disruptive technologies like this come in, they redefine what good means. That new device that comes in, it's never gonna succeed on being exactly the same as the larger device that came before it. It succeeds by redefining what good means. It succeeds on its own terms. Mobile's gonna succeed on its own terms, okay? Mobile's gonna succeed not by copying what the desktop does, but by being better in a respect that it defines for itself. And then it's like, guys, this is what we're doing. Like, we are the ones who are gonna make this happen. Like, we are the ones who are gonna make mobile so awesome that it changes the way that everybody interacts with the internet. And so this is why I'm so excited about this, because it's like, this is our chance. This may be the last great wave of interface transformation that some of us see in our careers. And this is our chance to go in and say, let's wipe away some of these outdated editorial processes. Let's fix our broken content management system. Let's clean up our badly written content. Let's use mobile as our opportunity to do things right, and let's do it right from the start right now. That's what I have for you today. Thank you. Oftentimes people want to argue that mobile is different and you should design for the mobile context. the examples that everybody uses is travel. You know, the example everybody uses, I'm looking for a hotel, I'm looking for a train, I'm looking for a restaurant, and that, you know what, that's totally cool. Like, call that local. Call that optimizing for the local experience, and let's have a meaningful but still separate conversation about how to optimize for local. And the reason I think it's important to call that out as not a mobile task, but as a local task, is that I think too often we fall into the trap of thinking mobile has to be totally different, and for the vast majority of scenarios, I think not only does it not have to be different, but it should not be different. I think there's, for the vast majority, it's like, for the 77% of people who are searching for information from their mobile device at home or at work, they don't want the information to be different, or written differently, or prioritized differently, or they don't want, you know, it's like, it would be really frustrating if you were looking something up and you got one set, you know, one type of content on your mobile device and a separate type of content on your desktop. Google also reports that over 90% of people start a task on one device and complete it on another device, which also suggests it's like, whoa, I'd be really annoyed if I got one thing, you know, if I got less content on mobile and then I went to my desktop and found out there was a whole bunch of stuff you weren't telling me, I would almost feel like my trust was violated, because I'd be like, I don't know what I'm going to get here. So I do tend to skew very strongly toward mobile. Let's not talk about how mobile and desktop are different. Our goal should be to provide the same, you know, do our best to provide an equivalent experience. Keep content and navigation and, in many cases, even priority the same on mobile. And if you're jumping out of your skin because you're like, but my air travel use case is different, well, then it might be a local use case and optimize for that.
Hi, Karen.
Hello.
Great talk. I wanted to shout out from the back of the room, hell yeah, about midway through. But I resisted. I actually have questions that fall on Tom's question there. So generally, I agree with you.
We're allowed to disagree too.
Yes. And actually, I would say that I have not seen this, like, I've not seen situations where this is the case, but I have had marketing departments at e-commerce companies, large e-commerce companies, talk about how they believe, and I, like, they didn't share any data with me, but they believe that people on mobile devices will buy different products than people who are on desktop devices. And so, you know, when you were talking about the Cancer Society example, where you said explicitly that the people who are demographics of mobile users would be the people who you would, like, that most need screening information. My second thought was, well, then does that mean that they should highlight screening information more strongly on mobile because of that data? And so the first question is really sort of specific to cancer, but the general question is, have you seen any examples like that e-commerce company where statistically you're seeing differences in behavior between different device classes, and thus, you know, differences in content because of it? Thus far, we haven't. So I'm like, you know, vast majority of the time arguing the same stuff you argue, but it did raise that question that you might have different clients.
Yeah, I think it is difficult to look at behavior and analytics data on mobile right now. Mobile analytics is still totally in the dark ages, and most companies don't have a really good picture of what their mobile customer is doing. I frequently quote the brilliant Jason Grigsby when he says that it is impossible to predict future behavior from a current experience that sucks.
You're throwing my own words back.
So I think I see people trying to, you know, evaluate analytics data or search terms on mobile and use that to say, oh, mobile behavior is categorically different. I think I would probably be willing to go on record to say I think the stuff that we're seeing right now is just sort of like artifacts of not having a huge amount of data, not having a huge amount of people who are interacting with these devices, and having a lot of experiences on mobile devices that are really crappy. And so we're just not getting entirely clear pictures. I mean, the idea of, mobile users would buy different products, I'm like, well, I think that is jumping ahead to a level of personalization that we are just not ready to do right now. And I'm like, look, if 5 years from now we come back and we're like, great, we've got the whole baseline level mobile content problem solved, now let's figure out how we like tweak for context and tweak for behavior, maybe. But I think I've seen too many organizations get all tied up in debating and hand-wringing over how mobile should be different, where I'm just like, hey, quit dicking around with those context debates. Get everything, you know, get all your good content up on mobile. Once you have all the good stuff up on mobile and you have real people interacting with it, then you can start deciding if you want to tailor the priority or the weight of things for different devices.
Hi there. I'll try to put my question in the form of a question, but it starts a little bit with an observation. I'm a copywriter myself, and so I love your emphasis on good writing, and I think it's spot on. But one of the things I often hear in Portland, at least, from a lot of small digital agencies and design agencies, is that they don't hire copywriters that either freelance or on staff, because the clients have always copied. And my response usually is, that's why you need a copywriter. But anyway, I was kind of wondering how often in your work you have come across that, or if you have ever recommended, look, you really need someone who focuses specifically on this. Because people are convinced this is a lot of the time that this is the easy place to cut corners. This is the thing that anyone can do. Anyone can fill in those blanks. But as you were showing, hey, really, maybe what you need to be doing is doing three different versions of a headline. And it's not easy to take something from, you know, 10 words to 4 and still make it effective and engaging. So I was just wondering how often you come across this.
So I kind of think about publishing on the web in like three eras, where the early phase one was back when IT was the only group that could update the website, and IT became a huge bottleneck. And at the point at which the marketing group or the business units were like, hey, wait a minute, IT doesn't own our website, we own our website. That was when we ushered in phase two, where everybody put on a content management system and we decentralized publishing. So we said, the whole point of having a CMS is that we were going to hand the keys, you know, give the keys to the CMS to everybody in the organization, and everyone can create content now. That was probably a necessary step in the evolution of the web, that we needed to make everyone in the organization feel some ownership over the fact that they could and should be publishing content, engaging with their customers, you know, figuring out what they wanted to say. However, when I look at mobile and I look at exactly the kinds of things you're describing there, that they need to structure content, they need to write alternate versions, and frankly, some of the inherent limitations of the decentralized publishing model, which is that you get a lot of crappy content. I think it's what I'm seeing is it's time for phase three to come in, which is, let's replatform our CMS, let's invest in a stronger structured content model, and then let's have a stronger editorial team. Like, it's not going to be IT updating the website, but let's have a central editorial team that they can be experts in using the CMS, they can be experts in writing, they can work with the rest of the organization to gather content, but for the really high value stuff, they're the ones who control publishing. And my sense is that for a lot of organizations, it's going to be a balance of defining like a very simple user role that can only do the most simple of updates, you know, simple of edits, and then all of the really complex stuff should be centralized in a core editorial team. Now, that really does depend on the type of organization. Like, if I go say something like this to higher ed, they laugh at me. They're like, you know, universities don't work that way. But if you're a bank or a hospital or a travel company, the idea that everybody in your company should be publishing to the web, I think, you know, it's like, it doesn't really work that way.
Hey, Karen. You talked about the study from Google that said people start with one screen and then move to the other, which they call sequential screening.
Sequential use, right?
For tasks where, I mean, where it's not like an edge case, but like where a user really would have a better experience moving to a desktop environment because either they need the real estate or like using a mouse, getting the detail. Like, we have a yacht company and we're like detailing our yacht or something, right? Do you have ideas for best practices about sort of setting those mileposts for somebody that says, now's a really good time to get off your little screen and go go to your desktop.
Yeah, so for example, I worked at the bank this summer, and one of the most shocking things that I saw in their analytics data was that they had literally tens of thousands of people, hundreds of thousands of people, who were fighting their way through online application forms that were designed for the desktop. I mean, these people were you would not believe how much work they were putting into trying to fill out a form on this tiny little mobile device. And I mean, it's like, go to this bank and they're like, can you see how badly somebody wants to become your customer here? So, optimizing those forms for mobile is a longer term challenge. I mean, it's not that they don't recognize that it's important, it's just that there's a whole lot of back office systems that get touched by that. It really is it's not something that you can just wave your magic wand over and have that form work perfectly. Somebody's gotta go in and do it, but they wanna do it right, and that requires a design and development process. So it's like, what do you do in the meantime? And one of the suggestions there is, okay, is there some reasonable way that you can direct somebody back to the desktop? Is there, can you give them an alert or give them the option to email it to themselves, give them some kind of like suggestion, like, hey, you want to do this later? I think that identifying those places where people will need to make the transition to the desktop, I think that's going to require a lot of thoughtful space planning. And right now I just see we're having worked it out at the very, very top levels of the website, and I think the real challenges are going to be, right, 4 levels deep, 5 levels deep, somebody's got to switch to the desktop experience. How do you alert them or guide them through that? And I think some of the patterns for how people alert users to that haven't really emerged yet, but I think they will have to.
Hey, Karen. So I work for a large organization, and we have a lot of multinational content that we create.
Right.
It's primarily generated first in English and then translated. Of course, the translation process is somewhat problematic. But how does this work out? When you get into those situations where you have your content generated by it's written great, but then go and get it translated into Russian, Spanish, German, Portuguese, Brazil, and Portuguese. How does this work when you go multilingual?
That is an excellent question. So, the localization problem and the multi-channel content problem and the personalizing by context problem are all the same problem. If you can figure out how to structure your content into the appropriate size chunks, and you can figure out how to target that according to some set of metadata and business rules, whether that is language or platform or data about users, all of those, it's like if you can do one of those things, you can pretty much figure out all of them. So localization and translation is, I think, one of the most, it's really hard, but if you figure that out, you're so well positioned for the future. And I think what's important is to remember that those are two completely separate problems. So what your process and workflow is for localization is something that you need to sort out as an organization. Like, what level does the central body have of control? What level do the individual regions have? I worked on an HR, a global HR intranet this past summer. And it was the same kind of problem where it's like, you have HR policies, so you've got retirement benefits policies for all these different countries. So they have to be localized, meaning retirement benefits from the US are not the same as in France and the same as in the UK. So the individual countries have to provide that content. In this scenario, they provided that content all back into corporate. Corporate wrote all of it. Corporate took the data, here's what our retirement benefits are in the UK. Corporate wrote it to be a consistent tone and consistent voice in English, and then they send it out for the translation process. And so the translation process, it's like, I'm a big fan of talking to everybody about your CMS and your editorial workflow that's unique to your organization. You have to figure out what that is. But the translation stuff, hire a vendor and work the way they want you to work. Do not try to figure out translation for yourself. There are, it's like, if you really have a massive translation workflow, You just need to define what your editorial process is up to that point. Make sure that you have everybody who's providing localized content gets that it's like lockdown, and then send it off for translation. If you have a process that requires, I will admit, I'm less familiar with a localization and translation process where individual regions are providing localized content that they are writing to be already translated. I'm less familiar with how that works because most of the companies that I work with want to have more centralized corporate control over things. That makes sense? So, but if you can figure this out, mobile will not phase you with it.
We'll do one more after this, and we've got it.
Hi, Karen. I caught your presentation at DrupalCon, so we'll be able to provide enough context relative
okay.
for everybody else to
right.
catch that as well. But, so on the one hand, I think some of what you're talking about is certainly some democratization as far as who can publish content on the web. And at the same time, you're also talking about shrinking that editorial staff, you know, and controlling how content gets published. And there's definitely sort of a type of war there. And there's two different goals in mind. And in your DrupalCon presentation, you talk a bit about metadata. And I think a little bit here as far as, you know, specialized content titles and, you know, shrinking those and having an actual content expert, you know, so we really understand how to publish to different formats and sort of contexts. And I see that those are definitely differing goals, or at least there's different challenges there for sure.
Yeah.
And on the one hand, we have the democratization where everybody should be able to do this. And on the other hand, there's definitely, it's like, well, there's certainly a lot of expertise involved. So how do we balance that while still providing, you know, the quality experience there?
Yeah, I think that's a good and really important question. Most of the stuff that I talk about, the structured content, metadata, writing alternative forms of things, the complexity in the CMS interfaces that is required to support that is to me something where it's like, I want that to be a really well-designed experience, but I also don't think I don't think it's possible to do that for a completely novice user. One of the things that I believe so strongly is that the consumerization of the web and the belief that everything that we make should be the iPad where your three-year-old can pick it up and you know, intuitively understand it. We have prioritized, you know, learnability and intuitiveness over efficiency and power for expert users. And so with the CMS stuff, I think there's a risk that, you know, as with the Drupal example with like inline editing, that you're over correcting for obviousness and ease of use, when really what you should be focusing on is efficiency for an expert-trained user. So, you know, when I'm talking about all this stuff, I think I am, in many ways, just trying to swing that pendulum back a little bit and be like, it is okay if you have expert users. It is okay if you have a core team of people who are trained. It is okay if you have some people who know what they're doing. Doesn't replace the fact, I guess, that you might also still have some novice users, but that's where I'd be like, okay, then give them the training wheels interface, give them the most simple tools to make, you know, it's like define that role, define what simple updates they can make. And for me, the risk is, okay, how do you make sure that the less experienced user can't go in and change things that that the expert user is like, oh, wait a minute, like, you updated that page title, and now that has cascaded through the system, and that page title is now showing up in places that it shouldn't. It's like, those are the kind of things where it's like, okay, you've got to build a system that can be aware of that. I don't know how we solve that problem, except just being really explicit about, oh, right, it should be okay to have a very simple interface for some users and a more complex interface for other users.
Hello. I don't have a question, but I have two plugs, and one is for you, and one is for Jim here. So for you, I want to encourage everybody here to get Karen's book. The examples in this book are so helpful. You talked about NPR being your go-to for how to do it right, and when you talk about through their Winnie the Pooh example and all these iterations, and you say, oh, I see how what can be done. It really opens up possibilities to see those concrete examples. And you do that all through your book. So really, it's excellent. Everybody should get it. And then Jim Wolfrey here mentioned that the Content Strategy Meetup group is having a writing workshop. I'll be leading the workshop, and one reason that I'm doing a workshop on writing for content strategists is because we're all writing or creating content or managing content for mobile and for translation increasingly. There was this question here about translation. If you're writing for mobile and for translation, you have double pressure to write clearly and concisely. So that theme of how do you write concisely, there are tools and tips, and you'll walk away with some if you sign up for the workshop. So grab one of those spots while they last.
Marsha also has a fantastic new book out too, which you should also totally buy, and you should also buy copies for all of the people in your organization who don't know how to write.
All right. Well, thank you very much, Karen. Thank you to Catherine and to Jim and to, Francis, for helping organize the event. Thank you all for coming. Hope to see you next month. And Karen, it was awesome. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you all.